Oh, good morning. I don't really see anybody in the background. Usually, I can see the people who are there. Anyway, so this workshop is a continuation of the work we started in a long time ago. But the idea was to implement this methodology in the center that we have, the International Center for Computer Solution, and this is work in progress. And obviously, we have written some other papers in addition to this, which I can make available later if it's necessary. So the idea is to give you an introduction to negotiation from a different perspective than the Harvard Business School approach. There's a problem in negotiation at Harvard. I don't know if you know about it, but that's more a traditional approach. So they don't do what we really do here. So this is practically almost an extension of their approach, so to speak. So conflict resolution, and I'm not going to bore you with the details of the when it started about 63 years ago, something like that. So you can see that people have started to look at conflict resolution in a more systematic fashion. And conflict resolution takes different flavors, like for example, people call it arbitration and mediation and resolution and things like that, and or negotiation by itself. It depends on what twist you give to the treatment of the problem, how people relate to each other, and so on. Here, we're just going to talk about generically about the concept of conflict resolution. Two parties, not three parties, or two parties only. Two parties have a sort of a problem and they try to solve it, right? So, traditionally, initially, people thought about conflict resolution. You have the two parties that are fighting each other, and so they look at each other as adversaries. So in 81, there was a book written by Fisher and Urey called Getting to Yes, which many of you probably know. It's a cheap book, about $5 book that you can buy today in Amazon. And in that book, they look at the problem
Yes.
differently than just conflict resolution as two adversaries. They talk about people should work together to solve the conflict, which is sometimes very hard, right? I mean, you have two people who are been fighting for a long time, how they come together and look at each other as problem solvers, that's kind of tough, but it could be done. So this approach uses four principles: separate the problem from the people from the problem, always separate the parties, not to have conflict. Find interests, not positions that they have. So don't tell me that you are more politically inclined to the left or to the right. Tell me what interests you have in the conflict. Invent options for mutual gain and find objective criteria. So this sounds very familiar to the HP approach, right? But one thing that is missing here is measurement. Many people say, and I always are in trouble with this, when I say that they don't really use math to really do the measurement. They just game theory assign some values to the positions they take. They take this action versus another action to get a value. But how they measure the value has always been controversial. So, of course, people say they have a utility and they can develop a utility function, which is very, well, it's hard in the parties, multiple groups of people obviously. So let me show you. So this is basically the approach that you think. We think that you have to measure the gains and the losses of the party as they give concessions. Concessions, for some people, is a bad word. And if you go to Palestine, you say concessions, the people will say, we have conceded too much already. So let's take it, let's call them trade-offs. So I use the word interchangeably just to give you an idea. So this is how basically you can look at negotiation. This is a traditional approach, which is a negotiation is like a contract, right? Binding agreement between two people. And obviously you have multiple dimensions. That's the reason why the multi-criteria is your approach. And so in the outcomes of negotiation can be two different types. If each party tries to look for their own gain, so you can see the arrow in the diagonal here, the blue arrows, each party looks for their own, that's called value gain, or value chain claim. That means that whatever I take from one, the other party gives away. And there are different ways in which this is not necessarily entirely always zero sum, but there are different dimensions to the value chain, how they gain or lose it. Like distributive is a typical zero sum approach. Integrative, there are multiple factors negotiated, and some of them are more important than to the others. And then some factors called compatible. where the same element is perceived as a gain for both parties or a loss for both parties. So this is how they look at the factors. Okay, the value creation, on the other hand, is when both parties try to look at the not at the other person as an adversary, but as a partner, so to speak. So looking at the Pareto frontier means that both of them will gain, and that's when you're looking at moving away from the zero-zero position at the same time, so landing somewhere in this Pareto frontier, which would tell you some party gains more than the other. The question is, what is a fair amount that each gets, so to speak, value? So that's what they call a value creation, because they try to find out not the position they adopt, but the interest they have, how they can trade them off. So think about, rather than having two people are getting divorced and they try to divide the goods they have, the typical approach is to be like sharing the pie, so to speak. So how do you share what you have? And so they fight forever. The traditional, but if you look at it as trade, as people who are actually partners, so to speak, they will gain more, because if they fight each other in opposite positions, in the end, they end up with nothing, which is usually what happens when their turn is there in the middle. So that's the reason why value creation is a way of looking at conflict resolution. Of course, it's difficult to implement, especially when you don't do measurement. Okay. So to illustrate the approach using the AHP, I took the simplest case they use in negotiation, which is a recruited candidate approach. You have a candidate looking for a position in a firm, and you have a recruiter. And the recruiter has a set of dimensions that they're thinking about. So to make it easier for you to understand that is, these are the dimensions they usually provide you with. Signing bonus, salary, a job assignment, company car, starting date, vacation days, moving expenses, reimbursement, and insurance coverage. And each of those has a scale. Now in this case, they make it very simple, it's equidistant, you can see the equispace. And they have a value for the recruiter and a value for the candidate. So, for example, if the recruiter gains, the candidate loses, that the signing bonus. Look at the other hand, for example, salary is a cost, right? You know, move in the opposite directions. Now, in some cases, they might move in the same direction. For example, the company car. The company car, whatever they adopt, when the scale decreases for the recruiter, it also decreases for the candidate. And the positive side, vacation days, it costs the recruiter, versus it doesn't gain anything for the candidate when it moves away from how many days vacation they have. So the idea is to select a level of each of these dimensions to form a contract. And that the question is, which is the right mix for both of them that they gain? So these dimensions have different categories. Like, for example, salary and job assignment, because they have negative numbers, they're called cost in this particular case. The others are all positive, that we call it benefits, so to speak. Of course, the amount of benefit differs from the recruiter and the candidate. So the whole idea is that because of the scales they're giving you here, obviously we can find, we haven't asked them to prioritize, and in the regular life, we would say to the recruiter, which benefits are more important to you, and the cost which costs are harder for you, and you get two sets of priorities. So we separate the cost and the benefit, you don't mix them together. Later on, we can do that at the end if you want to. So obviously, these are added to one, and according to the numbers that you have in the scales, this is how they prefer. For example, signing bonus, they both recruit an employee according to the scales, they have the same value. But in the insurance coverage, they have opposite values, right? So have moving up on their expenses. And the costs, they have the same value for both of them. Remember, these are coming out of the scales. I can show you in detail how this is computed. It becomes very involving, so to speak, but it's just a matter of details. The idea is to find out what level is the best one. So if they are a recruiter and you say, I would like to have a signing bonus of a given value, a salary, a job assignment, and so on, you get a value. And if you ask the candidate what he would like, that's what the trade-offs are, right? So this problem, these are the optimal solutions, but let me go. You can do it mathematically if you want to, benefits cost ratio. Okay. There's nothing here about in a conflict with the opportunity with perceived benefits or perceived costs. That's a different approach. It's a little more general than this. So for example, an agreement would be something like this. These are the scales and intensities here. And so you can do this for any conflict. You have identified the dimensions, identify the scales and the intensities. And then see if the recruiter selects one value, for example. If they agree to this, you notice that overall, based on the scale values and the priorities, the benefit-cost ratio for the recruit is less than the candidate. Now, if the recruiters know that the candidate is getting more, they say, wait a minute, this is not fair, right? Because I lose more. So agreements will have to be in both of them have the benefit-cost ratio greater than one. This is the optimal position. Now, of course, how do you get the optimal position? Well, we solve a max mean ratio problem, obviously, if you have the technology in front of you. And if you have complete information in terms of what each of the parties know, then you can agree on something that's beneficial to both. That's what they call value creation. And you move to the Pareto frontier. And if you go away from the Pareto frontier, then you lose. So this is the mathematical formulation. When they do negotiation workshops and they show you the example, they don't talk about math. They don't talk about the benefit cost ratio. But because we know that measurement is very important, if you look at it from the perspective of measuring the gains and measuring the losses, you can find out what the optimal solution would be for both of them, provided that we know their priorities. And you can play around with different circumstances, different situations. The scales will have to be linear like they are in this case. So the objective of the negotiation is to find the right mix, right? So for example, the right mix in this case, this is the optimal solution. Right? And if you put the actual numbers here, you get a total number of points based on the priorities, and it's 7,400 apiece. And so they agree on the bonus, signing bonus 6%, the salary, both of them lose, as you can see, they have to be in compromise. There's some dimensions in which one, the recruiter gets nothing and the candidate gets more, but then the recruiter gets on vacation days. And so that's the compromises happen. They don't have to agree exactly on the value of the dimension. Okay. It all happens with insurance and so on. So that's the idea of a trade-off. A trade-off is balancing the benefits and the cost in each dimension. And overall, you will have to get a value that is close enough to both of them. So if you are able to show to the parties that what you gain and what the other party gains are similar, very close, then maybe they will agree, because they will have to provide the priorities. That's the whole idea. So they will have to find the dimension. So as a negotiator in the middle, you will have to help them to understand how to get the dimensions, agree on the dimensions, and then build the scales. And of course, the scales are not the same for both of them. And that's where the difficulty comes. It's possible that if you do it in the way they recruit it, and if you don't give it to you in that fashion, you may not have a solution, right? Just could be an invisible problem. But the whole idea then is you have trade-offs. How do you evaluate those trade-offs? And so here you have steps. And so I have highlighted, as we look at the different components of the problem. So the first thing you do when you have two parties is identify the concessions, the trade-offs. So what are you willing to trade? What are all the possible trades? And then the whole idea, for example, we decided to study this very specific conflict because this is not something that you do every day quickly. It requires a lot of time. So we had an example in which this approach worked well with the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. So the concessions were identified by the parties. Now, the Israeli-Palestinian conflict was a retributive conflict because you assume that what the Israelis do provide them the Palestinians as a concession. It's not just because of the benefits they get from the trade, from the other concession, from the other party, but also because of maybe the pain, the cost of the people. So they're thinking about hurting each other. So you have to balance not just benefits and costs, but perceived benefits and perceived costs. That's what makes the difference in the relativity conflict versus the regular conflict where the parties are trying to get to an agreement. So they have to identify the concessions. So the concessions is something like the other party comes and says, this is what I want from you. So the Israeli concession is something that's not something that the Israeli wants to give you. No. The Palestinians comes and says, this is what I'd like to have from you. And of course, They can write some things as like abandon the idea of the Jewish state. They will ask, some party will ask for this asinine concept that they would like to have from the other party. But the whole idea about the study, this work, is that you don't have to get crazy and say, oh, how can you ask for things like that? Well, you can ask for anything. The question is, will you get it, right? So you can write down anything you want. So these are the 17 concessions that the group of Israel, Palestinians wrote for the from the Israelis. And of course, the Israelis will say, wait, wait, I know what I want from you. And here you have the Palestinian concession. For example, accept the two-state solution, Israel-controlled Jerusalem, or with the joint control of Jerusalem. You can see that 22. They don't have to have the same number of possibilities, right? They of trade-offs. You may ask for 1,500 things, and the other person asks only for 100, which are important to them. But the question is, how do you come together on the things that you're asking? Those are the trade-offs. So I have to match the concessions. So first we identify the concessions, ask the people to tell you what they want. So take, for example, the Kashmir conflict. Let's assume that you have, well, in this case, you have three parties, and it's a little harder, right? But nonetheless, you have the Pakistanis, you have the Indians, and then you have the Kashmiri. So the Kashmiri says, I have a set of concessions from both of them. The Pakistanis have concessions from the Indians, and the Indians have concessions from the Pakistanis. This is a study of three of them. It's a little harder. In game theory, they call it cooperative games with multiple players, but this approach so far, we have only done it for two players. So now you can see now the extension in research about doing it for three players. It's a little harder, right? But eventually we'll get there. So you find the concessions first, which is, what is the other party want from me? That's basically the question. The next step after finding the concessions, just to write up, you have to find out each concession the party gives sets a cost provided. So if I give you something, I have a cost for what I give you. And I think that when you get it, I perceive what you get, your benefits. So that's my perception of your benefits. And so it's the other party will give me something, they have a cost, and the perceived benefits that I have. But on my other hand, too, I also think that when you give me something, I have a perceived perception of what it costs you to give it to me. So that's the reason you have benefit cost, perceived benefits, and perceived cost. And these benefits, perceived benefits and perceived costs and costs, they have to be prioritized. That's how. So they basically went and said, okay, here you have. I'm not going to bore you with the hierarchies. There's a hierarchy of objectives. The objectives are economic, social, political, and so on. And so, for example, here you have the Israeli cost from these concessions. End of claims of independence and end of conflict. That is costly because the Israelis cannot ask for anything else. So that's a cost to Israel. Integrity and unity of Israeli society post-agreement. So people are fighting in the society. The legitimization of the state of Israel, security, stop being occupiers. Now the Palestinians have certain benefits from the concession. Controls of the holy places, that's what they think. This is a perceived Palestinian perception of Israeli perception of Palestinian benefits, okay? So this took a long time to put together. The study we started was 2009, Tom was still with us. And it took a long time to get to this place. So you have cost for, this is the Israeli cost, Israeli perception of the benefits, Palestinian cost, and Palestinian perception of the benefits. And then there's a set of benefits and perceived costs, the same idea, with priority. So you can imagine the amount of prioritization that took place, right? So they didn't prioritize the concessions, they didn't do anything like that. So first we have the concessions, for each party. Then for each of those sets, we have to identify what, how I benefit from the Palestinian concession, how much it costs me to give my concession, my trade-offs to them, and then how I perceive the other party gains or lose. Okay. So the next step is to, now the concessions have to be evaluated according to the benefits, costs, perceived benefits, and perceived costs. So in a sense, this is how we did it. This is the nice summarize. So party one has a concession, and party two has a concession. When party one gives a concession, party one assesses its costs, elapsed benefits to the other party. Now party two looks at this concession from party one and says, oh, how much do I gain from it? And how much do I perceive the other party loses? Okay, let's keep it together like that. If you multiply the cost times the perceived benefits, you get the loss to party one. And why do we multiply? Well, first of all, they are ratio scales. They're relative ratio scales. So they don't have a zero. You can't add them up. There is no units. By multiplying them, the whole idea is to find the benefit cost ratio. So basically, you are basically saying, tell me what is the ratio of benefits of the concession over the cost divided by the perceived benefits over the perceived cost. So look at that. Party two, that's symmetric, but the solution is not symmetric. The procedure is symmetric. So party two has assesses the concession. It does the same thing, cost to party two, perceived benefits to party one. Then party one looks at the concession from party two and says, how do I benefit? And what do I perceive them to be their costs? So now you have multiplied cost times perceived benefits, give you loss to party one. Benefits times perceived cost is gain to party two. So when you mix the gain to party one over the loss to party one, is the gain loss ratio to party one, and you take the gain of party two over the loss of party two, the gain loss ratio to party two. So it looks something like this. This is using the ideal mode, because since everything is divided by a constant, it doesn't perturb the solution. So for example, Israeli cost, the first one was the most costly. Remember what the first one was? Let me go back. The first one for the Israelis was abandon the idea of a Jewish state. Think about it. I mean, that is the most costly decision. Israel would not exist as it is if you do that. Okay, it's the most costly to them. I mean, they just, that separates from the actual participants in the meeting. And of course, that's what they benefit the most, eh? The Israeli perception of the Palestinian benefits. They think that by not being a Jewish state, they benefit the most, because there's a large Muslim majority in the place. And so there is a loss multiplied by 10 to the 6 to make it larger, to the product. So Israeli loss is the product of these two here. Then the benefits from that concession and the product of the two gives you the Palestinian gains from that concession. Okay? Multiply by 10 to the 6 to make it look like a number, otherwise it's just 0 point something. In the same thing you do now from the Israel, from the Palestinian side. Their concession cost them a lot. For example, they claim that 16 is the most costly to them. Well, let's look at what 16 is. Remember, this is not about what you and I think. They say, give up the demand for return, the refugee return. So this is a rhetoric that has been held up front all the time, saying we cannot have the demand they have the right to return to their possession, to whatever they have there. We will not, the refugees that left, we will not negotiate anything. So that's the reason why they said 16 is the most important, the most costly to give up. So they say, I'm going to give that up. Okay. Well, despite of all these, right, you have benefits and costs, now you form the ratios. So that's the next step. Gain loss ratios are constructed for each pair of concession. And then gain loss ratios are not symmetric to the parties, obviously. The symmetry doesn't exist here. Why? Because one party has more power than the other. So the question is that how do you equate, how do you claim the balance between the powers? What do you bring a third party in the US? So believe it or not, the US, despite the fact that it's always seemed to be leaning on the side of Israel, it helps the Palestinians a lot, because it gives them monetary, although maybe not in this administration, but even giving them monetary values, loans and help without payment back to build up the land, to build up the infrastructure. So they perceive, and if the Israeli get out of whack, then the U.S. comes around and says, wait, maybe we don't help you anymore militarily. So you see, there's always that person there. Now, the U.S. has not been involved in that for quite a while now, with the exception of deciding to make Jerusalem the capital, which, as you can see, is a no-no, because it's one of the concessions that the Palestinians want to have from the Israelis. Okay, so obviously it's a very involving matrix, you can see, and Israeli ratios and Palestinian ratios, and then the symmetry, there's no symmetry, you can look at that. So for example, Israeli concession number two, accept Palestinian full control of the borders. Okay, so Palestinians don't have control of the borders right now, but see, the Israelis said, we're going to give you, this is a state, therefore we have no control of the borders, you are in charge. They will no longer trespass over. And so with the fence, they call it the fence, it's not a wall. The fence that separates the two will not have to be there anymore because the Palestinians take control. Palestinian concession of accept mutually agreed upon land swap. So the Israelis take land, for example, in the neighborhood of Jerusalem, and in exchange for that, the Israelis give them land in some places. Initially, people thought you can't do that, you're going to give us crappy land. Like, for example, you give us land close to the Gaza Strip in the middle of the desert, there's no value to any of that. But that's not true, because you will see later on, if you want to read in the paper that Tom, Jerry Zucker, and I wrote in Decision Analytics, this shows you that the land swaps are actually very important. They're in very important rich areas that produce. In fact, you have wineries and so on there. So if you look at the Israeli ratio, it's 1.192, and the Palestinian ratio, that means that trading Israeli concession number two with Palestinian concession number one, the Palestinians gain more. So this would not be acceptable to Israelis, right? Because they are too far apart. So that's what we're trying to measure. Find trade-offs that are close to each other, within 1%, or within 5%, within 10%. So this is the next step. The pairs of concessions that both parties, which both of them gain, greater than one, and they are deemed acceptable, being the difference between the two is within the percentage. Now, which percentage do we want to take? Well, we started at 1%, you might not find solutions all the time. So that's the whole idea about fair and equitable ratio. What pairs of concessions are acceptable to both parties? Now, some people have said, well, why don't you do one-on-one? Well, that's interesting, you could do bundles, right? The problem with bundles is the details. And in this particular problem, a bundle is not that important as the actual each of the details of the concessions. So each concession has a value in itself. So the question is, when you put a bundle of two concessions together, what is the value of that bundle? Because there may be synergies, and we don't know how to compare that. Okay, so there will be an innumerable number of trade-offs. And so right now, to make it easier, we decided to do it in pair to see where we went. Okay, we did explore the possibility of bundles. So that's what the whole idea is. Mathematically, I don't want to bore you with that, is you form gains ratios like that. So benefits times cost, divided by the cost times the perceived benefits. That's the ratios for A and ratios for B. And so the fair and equitable ratios means that they have to be within each other. It's within an epsilon, the ratio. Okay, so basically, when we solve this in pairs, we selected the first matching. The matches were number 12, Israeli versus 6. 12 is the Israelis have to comply with all available applicable UN resolutions. It's a concession they have to give. They're not compliant right now, but they should. That's what the Palestinians want. And acknowledge Israel's existence as a Jewish state. Palestinians haven't said that, although Yasser Arafat said that they acknowledge its existence. Maybe now with the Arab state recognizing Israel as a trade-off partner, maybe this is becoming more true. So within 1%, this is a pair, and you take these two concessions out of the set, and you run it again. So you keep running it until you run out of concessions you can match. Okay? So this is where we got together, and then we said, presented the results to the parties, and that was with the Palestinian delegation, and the Palestinian delegation said, wait, let's do one thing. Let's select six concessions for each of them that they are in that set there. Some of them may or may not be in that set. So these are the six concessions that survive unpaired. This is not paired. This is just ordered in terms of the number of the concessions. Okay. So these said, okay, well, let's write something about what you would do with this, right? And these are called the principles. So what they did is, they mapped concessions, and let me tell you, these are the ones that were identified with the Pericles concessions, not all of them, others, if you notice. And they decided to write some principles, right? Let me make it a little bigger. There you go. So one means the principle number one. They merge Israeli number nine with five, the Palestinian five. So accept the two-state solution on the borders the 4th of June 1967. This is when they took Jerusalem, right, and the Golan Heights and so on. So in accept the two-state solution, which includes a non-contiguous state. So remember that the Palestinians want to have a two-state solution, right? But not all of them accept that. They want the whole thing. So this is the compromise for them. And as it includes a non-contiguous state, right? You have to join now Gaza to the West Bank. That's a really difficult problem, because how do you join them? They're separated. You have to make a corridor that goes, maybe you have an underground train, who knows? So number two, for example, they put together these two concessions. Accept the integrity of the West Bank and Gaza, allowing free and safe passage between the two areas, merge with Palestinian must guarantee that any agreement reached by Israel will be accepted and supported by the majority of the Palestinian people, both in Gaza and West Bank. You can see what the problem is, right? Whatever they agree, Hamas agrees, or doesn't agree, the Palestinian Authority agrees, that's the West Bank, the Hamas people in Gaza will say, forget about that. If you have a chance to look for their guiding principles, they are medieval, because they just want to say Israel has to disappear. Okay, kick the Jews to the sea. That's their principle. So you can see that together they merge this thing together, and you can see it's a balanced agreement, because the selection of the pairs are close to the main diagonal, which is the equality line, right? The Israelis are on the x-axis and Palestinians on the right axis. So here you have the ones selected, okay? And so they wrote these principles. The principles, I'll make it a little smaller. You can see that this was agreed upon in August 2011. We made a trip there to try to sell to them these principles. So you have the two-state solution with mutually agreed upon land, agreed upon land swap. Integrity, respect for West Bank and Gaza. East Jerusalem is the capital of the Palestinian state. You can start seeing now how we are different from what's happening in real life, right? East Jerusalem is the part where basically Trump has put the embassy. The embassy is located in the old consulate that is close to the Green Line, which is the line that separates the Jewish state with the Palestinian state in Jerusalem. And so that's the reason why they violated this principle. But that doesn't mean that this not be reversed. It could be reversed. Status quo at the holy places in Jerusalem. You see, they still want to satisfy that. Acknowledge the system of the Jewish state. Israel is a Jewish state. Evacuation of Israeli settlers. So now you have the occupiers in the West Bank. How do you have to move them out. So they agree that they have to evacuate it, or they can remain there. So what we did is, we took each of these principles and we developed each of them using a similar idea. If I want to implement the two-state solution, how do I implement this? So what does Israel have to do? What the Palestinians have to do? So Tom, in absence, Jerry Zoffer, myself, and a colleague, Amos Gura, an attorney from Utah, who used to be in the Oslo negotiations, writing a book with Springer about the whole conflict. Each chapter is dedicated to each of these concepts, so to speak. So you have the HP, you have the mechanism to make trade-offs, you have the actual trade-offs, you have how each of the principles is developed and implemented. So you have a fully implemented approach to the conflict. And you will see quickly that if you add the numbers, the gains for both parties were identical. Okay. So that's, in a sense, how you look at a conflict, whether they have the activity or not. How you how you use the HP to do it. But it takes a long time. Okay. So the idea then is to make this, if you want to start another conflict, if I have to start another, use another 9 years to develop it, it's going to take a long time. So why don't we make it automatic? So my idea was, okay, so there you have the International Center for Conflict Resolution. And what I'm working right now on is in developing, under the auspices of this center, developing a platform that will allow us to study conflicts using AI. And of course, the AI platform is the negotiator. So you have two parties, and the negotiator is impartial, obviously. So they don't know if they're negotiating with a human or with an AI platform or not. They know the other party. And so I have written a paper with my friend, Jose Maria Moreno from Zaragoza, about the cognitive part of this approach, in which we show what is needed to implement it in general. Of course, we show the Israeli conflict because you have the details, right? But imagine that one party does not want to negotiate, doesn't want to give you what they want. You have to kind of guess it. What are their objectives, right? So that's basically the idea of saying, okay, so can I use natural language understanding to get the literature printed on a particular party and understand, can I get from there the necessary information to get started with the negotiation approach? So there's a question. They said, is it possible that in the long run, the Pareto frontier moves forward, thus implying that the global value increases? Yeah, I suppose that this is always, as long as you're thinking in a positive sense and you're creating possibilities, is value creation, right? If you go the zero-sum game, it's one gains, the other loses, you can see that we will never solve this conflict, right? Regardless of whether you treat it as productivity or not. So in the case of the recruiter and candidate, if everybody entrenches themselves on the maximum gain, they will never agree to anything. So the only way they gain is by compromising. And that's where the value, the idea of getting to yes, is called the principle of negotiation. But it, as I said, you need measurements. You need to have the relative values of how people prioritize their objectives. Otherwise, you can't decide that one party gains more than the other. So just think about in your own life, you getting divorced, God forbid that that's happening, right? You say to yourself, okay, I'm going to use this approach. What do I want from my wife? And what does my wife want from me? Now, I may not know what the other person wants, right? And sometimes you will be surprised that maybe the other person just wants the dog. And you want the dog too, right? So what would you trade for the dog? If you say nothing, then you are in opposite position. So, but there are different dimensions. There's not just the dimension of, as I say, economic. It could be social dimension, loss of friends, and so on. So I suspect that this approach is very, very, how would I apply this approach, Luis Antonio Saludos? Yes, sir. How would I apply this approach? What do you mean, how I apply this approach? We applied it to the, we brought groups of Palestinians. Well, there you go. You bring Palestinians and you bring in the two parties, not very large groups. They have to agree, so to speak, that they are going to talk to each other at least. But each party can do the analysis by themselves initially. Okay. Now, power asymmetries, there you have, you may have to bring a third party to balance the power. For example, in this case, the US was the balancing party. Okay. In the case of the Kashmir conflict, for example, the Kashmir people want independence. We don't know all the details yet. As I said, I have not finished reading the entire book, but we can decide what do the Palestinian, the Pakistanis want, and what the Hindu Hindus or the Indian people want, India wants. And if you read the concept there, who has the most power, right? Well, the reason why the Indian people are there is because the Kashmir people were not given a choice. They had to make a decision between Pakistan or India. They could not be independent. That was Lord Mountbatten, I think. So asymmetry is, yes, very important. You have to find a party that will help you. So, for example, you have the Syrian conflict, right? And in the Syrian conflict, the Syrian people are, you have Assad, and Assad has the power with the Russians, right? So the only way that we could help them is if we are there. And if you remove the US from that part of the world, the asymmetry exists. So the only way that we were able to balance a little bit there, because ISIS was taking control of that, was by being in place. And unfortunately, we were removed, so to speak. So you have to find out who could be the power asymmetry. So let's think about two people. One is a, for example, the person has a lot of wealth, and the other person is just in that marriage, so to speak. And so how do you bring the asymmetry? How do you close the asymmetry? Well, that's an interesting concept. Maybe the quicker party can make friends with somebody on the other party to be able to have a dialogue. But the truth of the matter is that adopting opposing positions, most of the times, they don't gain anything. Only one gains and not the other, in which case, if you bring a balancing, you bring attorneys in, right? If you bring the attorneys in, you know what happens at the end. They end up with nothing. The attorneys take everything. So that's the part about dividing the pie fairly. Fair division, there are books written on that, fair division. They don't really use the relative measurement to determine the power of the parties, right? Now, we're not determining the power of the parties. You're trying to determine if you want to negotiate within the principal negotiation approach, then there you are. Otherwise, you'll have a war, right? And so sometimes you might not have a power symmetries. And in fact, the Israelis and Palestinians, the Palestinians have no power. And it's all about if the U.S. helps them to make sure that the other party doesn't abuse them too much. And that's not happening, right? We're not helping them too much. So how would I apply these? Well, as I said, you need to be able to get parties together. And that's the idea of the center, was to, since to bring people as scholars into the U.S. doesn't require the State Department approval, at least that's what I was told. I was thinking that perhaps you can bring in people from both parties into the common ground neutral, for example, the University of Pittsburgh. That's what the idea of the International Center was. And then maybe dialogue, do something as the Israelis, Palestinians, the same idea. They say, the thing that the, this is a question, they said, I think that the perceived benefit costs are more subject to ambiguity than of course. And that particular perception, right, is within the Kahneman-Tversky approach, right? That your perception of the loss is not, even if you're the amount is the same, it's not symmetric to the gain, right? That's very important. And that's exactly the reason why you need perceived benefits and costs. The perceived benefits and costs, they have their own scales. Perhaps I didn't show you all the detail. But if you have a chance, obviously, the perceived benefits are just as important as perceived cost and perceived cost as benefits and costs. And if you study the problem just with benefits and costs, you will not get the same result. So I don't know if I have more questions here down here. Yes, it is very important that you need to, in this particular situation, because you see, the parties may not like each other and they do things to each other, not for their own gain, but for the pain they cause. That's the part. So they do that because they're not getting satisfaction. So therefore, let's do it to make them suffer too, right? So for example, they couldn't get anywhere. And so what did the Palestinians do? They started to do bombings, remember? That's where defense took place. They created defense, the Israeli created defense, which, by the way, punished both parties. I would say not equally, but punish both parties, because if you go there, entire neighborhoods divide, including also the Israelis, get cut off. So yes, perceived benefits and costs are just as important or more than actual benefits and costs. And by the way, these benefits and costs are also ambiguous, right? Because we don't have an actual number attached to them. That's the reason why relative measurements are important. So remember, Tom said he always was putting forward the idea of measuring intangible. That's the most part, important part of the approach. So whatever way you want to approach the problem, you have to do relative measurement. Now, if you ask me to do the same with fuzzy, I don't know how you're going to do this with fuzzy negotiation. You have to make it some validity. I wouldn't try to do it with fuzzy. Complication within the complication. I think the judgments are already fuzzy enough as they are, but they're different. In academia, it's publish or perish, right? So that's basically the... So this is the idea, okay? If you want me to send you a couple of papers we just finished, one of them is about the cognitive aspects of multi-criteria decision-making and in the context of this approach, as I said, is think about an AI technology and the parties negotiate through that technology. Of course, you have to be able to convince them to do that. But that's the reason I said, once we become more viable, because right now we are in the middle of the pandemic, but we started a small project in at the center here between the police in a particular neighborhood in Pittsburgh and the community. And we had a session with the police, and then the community was ready to come in, and they agreed to come in and prioritize how they see the police, and the police how they perceive the community. And you'll be surprised what the results are. I have only one part. We needed to have another three more meetings. We got stopped, so we don't know where we are right now. It's not very viable to do online negotiations, so to speak, like we're doing with Zoom, right? Because I think that the value of seeing the faces of the people. But we use this. I use the same technology. I trained them a little bit on HP. We use clickers to do intensity of preferences. And we got a little bit of a result about the police, how they think about themselves, what they think their objectives are. The next step was to see, how do you implement this? What do you think the objectives are? What do you do to implement those? We were going to do the same thing from the community side. We got everything lined up, and then we got closed. So we had standby. The budget is there. I don't know if they'll take it away from us when the pandemic is over. So it's possible that we lose it. In the time being, what we're doing is we're writing papers on other areas which use relative measurement. For example, we wrote a white paper for which we got an award on how do you measure the impact of policy of gun laws on lawful owners of firearms. It's a theoretical paper that perhaps we'd be able to implement within the next 6 months or a year. And there's funding for that. We're trying to get it. For example, we wrote a paper recently on how do you measure the influence of the US in the world? And we're not doing very well, obviously. And then now we just discovered that the RAND Corporation got another paper around saying, how does China and the US compare in the Far East, in Asia, and how the countries are leaning in what direction? So we were thinking about writing a paper using this technology, so to speak. Not negotiation. Just the measurement of intangible. But that is the key issue in negotiation, measuring intangible. I think if you go the traditional approach with game theory, I'm not sure you're going to get very far. A long time ago, Tom Sardi had a student by the name Habib Golamnajad wrote a dissertation on OPEC and what the best decision for OPEC was in terms of as a game approach. And this is the first time I remember seeing the HP applied to game theory to develop the payoffs, by the way. So yes, it is possible to do that. I think that if you have a solution, I haven't proved that mathematically yet, but it's possible to show that the solution here is a Nash equilibrium, okay? But, you know, theory is one thing and practice is another. And it took us a long time to get the confidence of to gain the confidence of the participants, five Israeli, five Palestinians, very high up in their societies. So they were not just anybody in the street. But the main issue in negotiation is that you cannot take all the parties. You must take the middle of the 70% in the middle. The 50% on the left, the 50% on the right cannot help you. And we did try that. They tried people from both. We couldn't bring Hamas, but we tried people from the right wing in Israel and didn't work very well. We couldn't get to a compromise. Because their payoffs were off. I mean, they were willing to make trade-offs about the holy site, something like that. So when you see all the different concessions, some of them people were not even willing to that. So I guess I'll stop here. Don't want to repeat myself anymore. Any questions? Any suggestions? I know this is very fast. An hour is not enough for 30 years of work. But by the way, this my first paper on concrete solutions, it was in 1984. And I'm not sure that went in the right direction. But that's how we got started on thinking about this center. And Tom had a much greater idea about the International Center. It was a lot much more general, something in Geneva would have required funding from different countries. We were thinking something smaller. So we got a small grant from the chancellor in a program that for creating new ideas, and we got funded. And we got stuck with the International Center for Conflict Resolution. My friend Jerry Zoffer is the senior partner on this. And so we have a website, which is obviously standby. Everything is standby these days. And hope that we can get together with the police and the community to solve that problem, to find out how we can help them. And if it works in one community, we can go to other communities using similar approach. But and perception in this case, Elio, perceptions are just as important or more. Okay, wrap up.